George, everyone, wicked Josh and B, and I'm here live at the Atrium with Mr. Jonny Owen, my new best friend.
How you doing, George?
So, Jonny Owen, yep. Massive man, obviously. Who would you say, what would you say is your proudest moment so far in your illustrious career?
In my life? Oh, yes. That's a good question, George. I was given an award once. It was called Sons of the Coalfield. My father worked underground, on my grandfather's, and they give an award out every year. In 2008, they gave me a Davy lamp. With the Coalfield Award for Artistic Endeavour. It was for a documentary I did called Aberfan for ITV Wales and Sky. And I was very proud to have that, and my father was as well, so that's got pride and place in my house.
Awesome, lovely story. And sorry? Who would you say is your biggest inspiration in life?
In my life?
Yes.
My paternal grandfather, who helped bring me up. He was a great film fan, great music fan, very encouraging, bought me my first guitar. And I had a great education from him musically. He was a big fan of Frank Sinatra, but he sort of always gave me money for music and also films as well. I watched a lot of old films with him, George, stuff with Charles Laughton and old Frank Capra films. Yes. So I'd say he was probably the biggest inspiration I had.
And what would you say is your proudest moment? No, I've already guessed that.
Sorry. This year, actually, being interviewed by you.
Right. Okay, Jonny, there is an eternal battle going on right as we speak. Literally, thousands have died in the eternal battle of who's better, Lady Gaga or Madonna.
Oh, right, that's...
And no, Lulu is not, that's incorrect.
Okay, I'm going to go with Lady Gaga. I'd upset a child saying that in the background, but I'll tell you why. My daughter is a big fan of Lady Gaga, and I know she's massively influenced by Madonna. But I'm going to go with Lady Gaga because I think she's got great attitude.
Yes.
I love that meat suit.
Yes.
And she also gave a nod to the Sex Pistols, which I thought was fantastic of her. So anybody that likes the Sex Pistols is fine by me.
And Bad Romance is literally the greatest thing the human race has ever achieved, apart from Mr. Jonny Owen.
Thank you, George.
Thank you so much.
That's all right.
Thank you.
I enjoyed it. Cheers. Thanks very much.
Hi, I'm George from Wicked.tv and I'm here live at the Atrium with Vicky. Hello. How are you?
I'm good.
Vicky McClure.
Yeah.
You've got hard surname, I'm sorry.
That's
got
all
to be
right.
Said. Right, first of all, first question. Obviously, what would you say is the best way for young people to get into the industry?
The best way is just to follow your own path. Do it the way you want to do it. Don't follow what everyone else is doing. Do it the way you want to do it.
As Madonna Ciccone once famously said, it's best yourself, obviously. So, what would you say would be your proudest moment so far?
In my career would be winning a BAFTA.
And who would you say is your biggest influence on your work?
On my work, I always struggle with because I'm influenced by the people that I work with. So people like Jonny Owen and Johnny Harris and Shay Meadows, they are a big influence in my career. So
Okay. Well, brilliant answer. That didn't offend anyone. Okay. Yeah. Obviously, there's battle bigger than World War One, World War Two, Harry Styles versus Taylor Swift, and that is Lady Gaga versus Madonna. Which matriarch of pop would you choose?
I'd go with Madonna. Sorry.
I'm not bitter at all. And obviously, there's another even bigger battle.
Yeah.
Circles or squares?
I'd go circles.
Yeah. Circle of life.
Circle of life.
Who faster? What's it?
It's just there's less corners to worry about, and
it's brilliant. Thank you, Vicky.
That's
all right. You've been a darling.
Oh,
thank you.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Becoming a celebrity cocktail. beautiful shaft. Do you have the balls?
You would make an excellent addition to my collection.
It's like you're screaming, and no one can hear. You almost feel ashamed that someone could be that important, that without them, you feel like nothing. No one will ever understand how much it hurts. You feel hopeless, like nothing can save you. And when it's over and it's gone,
you show your own back, don't you?
You almost wish that you could have all that bad stuff back, so that you could have the good.
To Jonny and Vicky as well.
I think, from what I can see from the sort of people who are here, there's a lot of people who are interested in getting into the media, working in film and TV. Does that ring a bell with anyone? Yeah, there's a few nods. So I think there's a common belief, really, that getting into the TV and film particularly is very difficult. It's a bit of a closed shop. I think that there's not... I think everyone you speak to tends to have a very different story of how they got in, really. That seems to be my sort of reading of it. And I thought maybe we could talk, first of all, about pathways in and how your individual stories of getting in, really. So, Jonny, do you want to go first, just to sort of...
Yeah, I was...
Where you started out, where you came from?
Yeah, I'm from North I was in a band basically in my sort of late teens called the Pocket Devils, and we got signed to Warners and we played around the place, and then a CV started in Merthyr Tydfil, where I'm from, in the late 90s, called Nuts and Bolts, which was cast predominantly from the people in the valleys, and somebody there, the casting director, asked me if I'd be interested in doing some acting. I'd never acted before. I mean, being like a flower in a play, so I was a bit reticent, and he said, look, come in and do some screen tests, and I did, and it was an amazing apprenticeship, because it was, I think, 30 episodes, wasn't it, a series?
Oh, at least it was, wasn't it?
Yeah, so there was, you know, and they were half an hour episodes, four series, so, you know, hours of television in that, and then you get an agent, really. It's a bit of a chicken and egg thing, and I got an agent, they grew up the parts, casting and stuff, and it was kind of, that's how I started, really. It was just the fact that things were being made in South Wales, which is why I believe passionately that regional television and regional dramas, regional films are really important, because it just gives people an opportunity to have a go, you know, and that was my kind of start in the industry, really. So
had you thought about acting before? Was it because music was your thing? Was that what you were focused on? Had you always sort of thought one day I'm just going to be?
I was always into films,
right?
And I was brought up by my paternal grandfather, who had a great love of films. He was a big fan of people like Frank Capra, Houston. So I had a good. There's that great Quentin Tarantino line. They said to me, "You didn't go to film school." He went, "No, I went to films." And it's a bit like I was a big fan of that world, the movie world. So I had quite an understanding of it, and I think being in a band sort of taught me about performance and confidence and all those things that you kind of need, and to be comfortable sort of speaking in public and like I said, performing. So it was kind of like a natural transition for me. I hadn't acted before. Once I started acting, I wouldn't say, it sounds conceited to say I found it easy, but I was aware that there was a way of doing it in television where you had to be as natural as possible. And for me then, it became an advantage, because every time I went for auditions, the directors and the casting people would be really interested in that, because I wasn't from a theatrical trained background. So I didn't know about stuff like projecting voice and maybe overacting in some respects. My apprenticeship was on television, where everything has to be done as subtle as possible. And I had a brilliant partner, really, in that series called Roger Evans, who's an actor, David's brother, who was brilliant. And he'd gone to the Guild, and we were chatting about the day, and I kind of sort of said to him, "You taught me how to act, really." And he went, "No, you taught me how to act," because he'd come from that theatrical background and realised actually it was wasn't. So it was kind of like, it's quite interesting because American film schools or drama schools, they teach television and film acting. They don't do it in Britain. So you spend like terms and terms just being on a camera and that kind of thing. And you know, that was what where my start was with Nuts and Bolts and how I kind of like progressed. I was into music as a kid. And I was really into 60s music from about the age 12, 13. I see a film called Quadrophenia, and I really liked kind of like Margie Barnes, The Jam, and I got into the Beatles. And I was aware in the mid 80s that I was a bit odd compared to other kids who were into stuff like U2 and Duran Duran. And I spent hours in Cardiff going around record shops and picking up fanzines. And this, like, there was a shop called Buzz and Co. Is it still there? I don't know.
Yeah, it is.
Where they just sell fanzines like Fire and Skill and. And all those sort of 60s fantastic expectations. And there was a series on the BBC called The Rock and Roll Years in the 80s, I don't know if people remember this, which used to sort of play music from that period. And I got into really sort of West Coast stuff and like Buffalo Springfield and all that kind of stuff. So I was kind of, my first love was music and that side things in the arts. And Merthyr then had quite a few people like that with music as well. So that was the big thing with the Valleys for me and still is that there are really interested people in Southern Valleys. And I found them, you know, you kind of congregated towards each other. So when you go to drums, these schools and these courses and that, what's the best thing was you find those people who like you. And that's what's really important is once you find those people, it kind of gives you a spur then to think, well, I can do this. Mm-hmm. You know, there's people like me who like these kind of things. And that's kind of like my start.
Okay. Is that similar to you, Vicky, or is it?
Yeah, I suppose it is really. I went to a workshop. I started dancing when I was about three, because I was just one of them annoying kids that just, you know, constantly needed to be doing. So I was sent to dance school, which I enjoyed. But they had like a drama class there, which was terrible. It wasn't their fault. They were just, you know, trying to expand the business, I guess. And then they said, oh, you know, we should get us somewhere else. And I went to a place called the TV Workshop in Nottingham. Which is still running today, and when I went there it was free, so it was a big advantage because I had auditioned for things like Italia Conte, and you know, it wasn't that I'm from a broken home, it's just their fees are excessive. Mm-hmm. So for people to be expected to pay those kind of fees are just, you know, if you've got both your parents working, it's still too much. And do you know what, it's a good job I didn't go, because the workshop is, it's, I was there for 10 years. And it's given me all the grounding that, you know, I needed as an actor. And what they specialise there is improvisation, which is mainly how sort of Shane Meadows works for like This Is England and stuff, and a lot of what I did with Jonny and Svengali as well. So it's something that if you go to, you know, I say it a lot, say maybe rather, they just get a different type of training, and that's why we are slightly different.
Yeah. That's interesting. So workshops and attending sort of training, like it's formalised, but it's not the sort of maybe traditional training?
Yeah, it's not like code at life. Jonny was saying, I never got taught different accents or mm-hmm. how to project. I just got taught to find the truth. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we do things like Shakespeare. And I remember Ian giving me the main role in Measure for Measure, and I was just like, I don't know what you're doing. You're going to have a terrible failure. So I don't have a clue what any of this means. Because I didn't study it at school. I wasn't really interested, and you know, it wasn't my thing. And I did understand it, and I did it, and I pulled it off, and you know, we pulled it off our way. And that's the great thing about it, is that, you know, it wasn't meant to be the best Shakespearean play ever shown. It was just meant to be done the way we wanted it to be done. And, you know, things like workshops and things that are local are put out there for people not to go, when you leave the workshop or when you leave this place, you're going to be a fully fledged actor and everything's going to be great when you go. You just kind of leave somewhere going, I'm part of something, and I've learned a certain skill about confidence and about expressing yourself. And it was funny, we were having a conversation earlier and we were saying, weren't we, it'd be great if we could get all this into school. So it's like, you know, you have to find different ways of expressing yourself and having that time, but I would never have been able to have done that at school because there'd always be somebody in my class that I didn't like, and I wouldn't want to make an idiot of myself in front of them at school. But when you choose to go somewhere like a workshop or a course or whatever, people don't mind if you cry, they embrace it, they want to see you, you know, show your emotions and act like a complete idiot.
you know, if you, I'm not funny, but I can be there because I don't care. I'm not, you
just
know, being
a
judged.
Safe environment,
yeah, it's a safe yeah. environment, and
she is funny.
Yeah,
I'm not.
Right.
But, it is. That's why things like that are so important. It's a similar kind of thing for, you know, for Jonny. It's just, it's all good and well going to London and thinking that, you know, that's where it needs to begin. It, don't get me wrong, London is full of opportunities, mm-hmm. but it's certainly not the be all and end all.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that personally I think that, of course, the media in London is massive, but then there's so much going on outside of London that you don't necessarily need to be in there or from there to get your start, really.
Yeah.
So do you think, coming from outside London, you sort of see, do you feel like an outsider if you go in and then sort of go to these auditions, etc.?
Yeah.
You're not from the
I still do.
Yeah. It's kind of a double edged. You can make it an advantage for you. And what I mean by that is that if you've got sort of a specific accent and you're, you know, comfortable in yourself and confident, they kind of like that. It's, you know, it's all right. You, if you go there and you're cowed or intimidated, believe you me, they'll know straight away, and you know, you won't get any joy. So you kind of, in London, I definitely think that with age, I've got used to London. It's very intimidating, big, scary place when you go there when you're late teens and stuff. And once you sort of learn to cope with that. And the most important thing is to know is that you're going to get rejected loads. But don't worry about that at all. I mean, and that's just going to happen. People are just going to say no all the time. But you just get a thick skin. You know, you just go, that's all right. You just keep going. And you learn from it. You know, but the most important thing to remember is that everybody goes through it. Believe you me, every single actor. There's a great story about Johnny Depp saying that he wanted to do a part. It was Hugh McGregor, and it was for the beach. And Hugh McGregor done Trainspotting. He was a big, well-respected Hollywood actor. You know, just a Star Wars, I think. And he was just about to start shooting Danny Boyle, who he'd done Shallow Grave with, and he was bumped to one side, literally days before shooting. And the reason was Leonardo DiCaprio read the book and said, "I want to do this." And what he realised was, there's always somebody in the food chain that's higher than you, always. You know, there's maybe one person at the very top, which is Leonardo DiCaprio, who can do anything he wants, but it's pretty unlikely going to be him. You know, it's because, you know, that's a one in a, I don't know, man, you know, a billion chance. So you've just got to remember that rejection comes with the job, but don't ever let that affect you. If it does affect you, and you fall by the wayside, then you weren't meant to get. But you know what? In your head, you think, this is fine. Everybody gets rejected, and Vicky was saying on the way up, but you know, Vicky's after being an actress, considered one of the best actresses of her generation. She said she spent 5 or 6 years literally just getting knocked back and knocked back and knocked back. This was after Room for Romeo Brass, which was a fantastic film, huge critical success. She was 15 doing it. And then she spent years just plodding away in London, and then obviously an opportunity comes like this is England, and that projected her, you know, stratospheric. But, you know, there was a period in her life where she was just getting rejected all the time. I mean, I did, not me for argument's sake, I did Tom Jones, which was a big hit in Welsh, you know, cinema, went network and all the rest of it. And then the BBC did a thing called The Fabulous Baker Boys, I think it was called. And everybody said, you know, you're a shoo-in for lead part. And I was like, oh, brilliant. Read it, it was about minus something of valleys, and I thought, oh, this is perfect. I mean, I went along the missions, and I was done the last two, but I didn't get it, you know. And I thought, I should have got that, but I didn't. And it was a good lesson. I thought to myself, you know what, I was getting a bit cocky, and I thought, I should be offered that part. But you can't, you can never think you're going to be in that position where anything will come easy, because it won't.
It's always the ones you want as well. I really wanted that one.
She nearly got.
Or I'll go for an audition and do a really bad reading. And I remember for the audition for Line of Duty, it was terrible. And I was like, yeah, being really confident and dripping water all down my face. Sorry. Oh my God, what's wrong with me? I was just all of the tears. And I got the job. I was like, are you sure? Because to me, it was the worst audition I could have done.
Yeah.
I just wasn't concentrating, I wasn't all there. And then when you think you're really well prepared and you've actually learnt your lines for an audition, you go in and you smash it and you're like, yeah, and then they come out and
they're like, oh. You were up for, she was up for, Natalie Portman got the job. She did Room for the Grass. She's up for Princess Leia. And she's,
you know,
Vicky,
I mean?
Said to me since, if she'd got that, she'd be a different person. She's like, same with me, I was in this band, the pop there, we were signed, just after Stereophonics in Catatonia. And I was saying to Vicky the other day, I'm so glad now I didn't
we didn't go through the roof at 2021, because I don't know what I would have been like at that age. Mm-hmm. You know, don't know if I would have been, you know, the person I am now that was able to go, all right, that didn't work, start again, bump, and do the other thing. But I don't know if having it too easy is a good thing.
So you do a lot of growing up in that phase. You think, yeah, just that constant rejection.
I tell you why, because it's, you are it. It's like you can't, you know. I remember going to London first time when I was 16 on my own, absolutely petrified of London, of everything, getting on the train, you know, just the audition, everything about it. And, you know, yeah, it becomes easier, but you can't take someone with you every time. You know, there'd be the odd time where I'd say, Mum, will you come with me? Or, you know, when you're in that audition room, or when you're on set, or wherever you are, whatever you're doing, you can only rely on you, because it's a one-man band. So I suppose that's...
I did audition about 10 years ago now. It was for Casualty, right? And my agent said, oh, they really like you, they really want you, you know, they've seen loads of stuff new, and it's a permanent part. And I remember saying, oh, I don't know, it's Casualty, I'm not really sure. And she said, I should go and do it as a doctor, it's a permanent part. So I was like, yeah, go on, I'll go and do it. And there was two things that I'd do a thing to camera where I'd be in character. And then there was a piece after where they had to pretend somebody was on a gurney, you know, brought in and resurrected. So I had this piece to camera, and I was fucking brilliant, right? I asked all the questions, and they were going, you could kind of see them going, he's going to get me, he's perfect. I was like, God, my backstory, and I was, this is great. So they went, right, brilliant, Jonny. So could we do the next scene, which was a written scene? And I kind of went, yeah. So I think, I mean, it was a bit where the guy had come in, he was dying, and I was a doctor that came in, and I went, bring him in here. I said, you need to get the injection, Xanax 4, 2, 3. And I think we need to get the Xanax 2. I was called the Xanax. I was going, oh, you're fucking dead. And they laughed, and I laughed. But I knew the part had gone then, because there was no way that I was able to cope with all those sort of, you know, medical terms. And I remember leaving thinking, nah, but so, you know, there's been times when I've done awful auditions. I did one once where I went into like this BBC thing, and it was quite a well-spoken director. It was quite serious. Glasses and his nose and on them types. And I prepared this thing, I read the thing, and I thought, done it. Like long piece, you know, half a page, but finished it. Yes, very good. Could I have it in English now, please? And I thought, well, I'm not good. So there's things like that happen, you know, and you just think, you know, it's part of the game, you know, you just go, fair enough, you know, this is the way it is. So, you know, bottom line is just don't worry. Don't worry if you don't get parts. Don't worry if you don't get into a college, perhaps. You know, it's not a big deal. Find your own way.
One thing I used to do, and I was talking to Kerry Collins about this earlier, is my first agent that I had was a massive agency, and awfully well spoken. And obviously, then there's not anyone comes in. All right. And every time she'd ring me, she'd go, oh, hello, Vicky, you all right? And I'd go, yeah, I'm good. How are you? Trying to talk like not me,
yeah.
And what I learned from that is I go into meetings and do the same thing. Go, hi, yes, yeah, really good, thanks, really great. Like really awkward. I'm already nervous, and now I'm putting on this, you know, show. And what happens is if I get the job and I get on set, they'll be like, oh, you weren't like that in the meeting. You just want to be yourself, you know. That's what people. A lot of what goes on in this business is personality. And
yeah.
They want to see your personality, and it is a, you know, it's a huge part of it. So.
Yeah. When you were first getting the knockbacks and rejection, was it a big struggle for you? Was it sort of, did you learn to cope with it after you had to go through it first of all, or did you have anyone to maybe give you a bit of guidance on how to deal with it, really?
Well, there's a saying, isn't it? People go, you don't take criticism well. I mean, nobody takes criticism well. I mean, you would be human if you didn't get a bit hurt. It's like showing some of your baby, oh, it's got big ears, you know, thanks. So it's a bit like, come on, you know. So, you know, it's not to say that it's difficult, you know, and it's been happening to me right up till today, you know, when I show people the film, you know, some film companies went, not for us, and kind of go, you know, can you see that that's the best film ever, you know, in your head? But they kind of go, well, it's not for me. So it's all down to personal opinion and personal taste.
Mm-hmm.
And the people who have that opinion of you, you've just got to learn this one person, you know, it's just one person, so you kind of rationalise it and think, I just think it takes me less time now to get over the rejection than it did maybe when I first started off, where you'd just be a day or two thinking, oh God, this is never going to happen, and I'm never going to get a part, and I'm never going to work again. you just get over things quicker and you just kind of learn to go, you know what, it's the way it is, put it in a box and put it on the side and move on. Do you know what I mean? It's just the way you've got to cope with it.
Yeah, I mean, it's like you were saying earlier, you tend to, as people, you tend to just sort of gravitate to people that you get on well with and have similar creative, you know, ideas, and you'll find your way. And I, you know, I can't say everybody that I've worked with has been, is turned into my best friends. You work with some people that you didn't really gel with, and that's just part and parcel of life. But if you didn't get a job, there's a reason for it, and then you know, it's down to the fact that you're not right for the job. And I can't tell you how many times I've been rejected or not got the job, or you know, spent thousands and thousands of pounds. This is one thing that does get my back up about the industry, is that it costs us so much money. You know, we've got like people that are hugely talented in, you know, in Nottingham and Wales and all these places that aren't London. And to get yourself to London, it costs you probably £100 a pop by the time you bought your ticket and you've got some food. And you know, that's the reality of the situation. And I had an office job for 8 years supporting me to get there and back, and it was only just before I started filming This Is England 86 that I left it and thought, right, I'm gonna just leave and hope to God that it works out, because if not, I'm back to the office. And you know, you've got to take chances as well. It's like, you've just got to believe in what you're doing, and know that you've got good people on your side, and them people, they're your family, you know. Yeah. They're the crux of it. And my sister and my mum and my dad and everyone, they'd all have to take so much, like, oh no, she didn't get it again. You know, is she ever good? Is this all? So for them, they had to keep my spirits up, and they did. But my mum was also, she was great at going, we didn't get it because you're not right for the job. And I'm like, all right.
There's a great story. I don't know if it's true, but I hope it is. Michael Caine, I think, says that he was doing a part and he really wanted to pay. Wanted you to, I'm going to get this part. There's no chance I'm not going to get this part. I'm going to do all I have to do, learn the lines and blah blah. He just absolutely pumped up. And he said, right, this is it, the part. And he walks to the door and they go, next! There's a line on the side of the door for somebody to think, well, he's too fucking tall for the part.
Oh, no.
So, you know, sometimes it's literally that, you know, I think you just go, you're just not tall enough, or you're not short enough, or you're not, you know, whatever, hairy enough. It's just set of reasons, so you just got to go.
Can you feel it, like when you walk in the room, within a few seconds, you've walked into the room and you can tell, can you tell that you're not what they want? Because they've got, do you think they've got the picture in their head of who they want for this role, and maybe it just isn't you?
Yeah, but I will say one thing. For me, because I have been to that many auditions, it was great, because I got to meet a lot of casting directors, and whether or not I walk in the room and know that it's not my bag because I don't want the job, if you offer it me, I don't want it, but I'm going because it's a casting director I've not met before, it's a job that I haven't really been seen before, you know. Like, that is all part and parcel of the job, really, is going to meet people. Even sometimes you'll think, oh, it's not something I want to get involved in. So you probably don't even give it your all. And, you know, that's just the reality of the game. You've got to go meet people. But
the worst one is when it starts really well, and you can feel it going afterwards.
Yes.
Losing this, trimming this, that happens quite a lot as well.
Yeah.
Do you know what? You just get in there and all of a sudden just a rush of nerves come. I'm telling you, you get there, you prepare yourself fine, and then by the time I'm sat in there, I'm sweating, I'm flustered, I've forgotten the lines that I've learned. You know, naturally, you know, it doesn't matter if you're an actor and people think that you're stupidly confident. It's like an awkward room with a big table and like four people sat there who aren't it, you know.
Yeah.
Really interested, just pound those, hello.
And you'll get
and
the
then
cast,
you're expected to go, but the thing is, I'm doing this massive piece and you're going to cry. And it's like, well, I just don't feel like doing that right now because I've just come off the street.
Yeah.
You know,
they read the lines to you as well, when they? Dead, dead pan. Yeah. So you've got a line where you go, my father, he's dying. And they go, so what's wrong with him? You're acting off that a lot of the time as well.
Because that person's read it however many times.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, they're well
stupid.
Yeah,
they've seen all the performances. So just basically the crux of it is just don't be too hard on yourself. Seriously, just don't be too hard on yourself.
Mm-hmm. So now are you sort of at that stage now where you're looking to, well, obviously for you, Jonny, you know you've been developing a lot of your own projects and things like that, and you're not really pigeonholed within
sort of just acting or whatever, and obviously you come from a musical background as yeah. well. Do you think it's important to sort of just get off your backside and do your own thing? Is that
yeah? I mean, for me,
things come to you.
For me, it was. I mean, there's only two types of actors in the world that work all the time. It's a really good advice. There's Hollywood A-list and soap actors. Everybody else just muddles around in the middle, and you always have a few months off. It's just a fact. And Vicky will tell you this. You know, she's been off for 3 months, whatever, 4 months, I think.
Since loving
it. Yeah. So you're not going to work all year round unless you're on a soap or unless you're on the capital. So what I wanted to do was I wanted to do other stuff. So I went into sort of producing and things like that. Weirdly, my degree was in history, and HTD as well as ITV Wales, they had a space in the sports department. And I went there just to do some research, I was a big football fan, and it was a bit of a labour of love for me, and that paid the bills really. And they still let me go off to do acting jobs when I could. So I got to a position where I could start to pick and choose the first time, it was great. So I was able to say, oh, I don't want to do that, and I'll do that, maybe just do one or two jobs a year. And then there was a space coming up in the history department, and I just ended up producing and doing stuff for them and writing. Ooh. So I got an idea of budgets, and I could control budgets and control, you know, not control people, but look after people and pick sort of researchers and things and cameramen and just make programmes. So it was a really good education. I loved working there. I loved working in regional television as well. A huge advocate of it, you know. And it was an opportunity. I mean, David told me earlier on, it's just giving people the opportunity, really, you know. And Cardiff is and should be a media hub. It's the capital of the country. There should be programmes in the media. There should be drama. There should be. But also the work should be going to Welsh people. And on the film Svengali, I made sure that I employed Welsh people on that crew. I got two lads started, one in particular, Alex Ashman, Kerry's worker, who's gone on to do other stuff now. Mm. And so I was very keen to just create opportunities for people to start jobs. You know, one of them, Mikey, was just a runner, but he ended up, you know, second, and Alex ended up as a production manager and stuff. So they were able to work their way up. And it's just giving people that opportunity, that start, where they can get in somewhere. And that's what happened to me. I was lucky. There was a place in Wales, HTV as well, that had a remit to make programmes. I was on television, so there was an opportunity for me to go make stuff. And it was a brilliant dedication because I would go into the head of IT Wales, was called Ellis Owen, and he was the head of BBC Wales, I think you might still be.
He is head of
Wales. He was from Caerphilly, and he used to talk to us, hello, how's it going? And he'd go in and he'd go, all right, and you'd go, I need three programmes. And he'd go, all right, and you go, one on, I don't know, the roads of Wales, rubbish, it's crap. One on Bridges of Wales, is even worse. And then they go, what about the last miner to play for Wales? And you go, oh, I like that. Mm-hmm. Who was it? And I go, Karen Jenkins. You go make a programme, three programmes, go see the accountant, you know the budget, sort it out. You leave, you go, fuck, I'm going to make three programmes. It was a brilliant way of doing stuff.
It's
amazing. Yeah. You know, just stuff on Tom Collery and well, I just so much stuff there that was just great, that really informed me, you know. And then, you know, sadly, there's a gradual running down of regional television. All of this stuff opening back up again. I think Channel 8 next year is going to be given to franchises, which is great. Yeah. The government's gone again, we need a balance to BBC regionally. You've got to have that balance of, you know, programmes being made. And as a kid growing up, it was really funny because HTV was Welsh TV, it was Harlech television. And when you were a kid, BBC Wales was kind of like a bit, not posh, but they spoke really well. And that. But HTV was kind of like the programmes of the valleys. Mm-hmm. So you had all those like amazing programmes when I was a kid, like Your Century, which was about all those towns in Wales and stuff like that. And they used to have phenomenal viewing figures. That's supposed to say, like 50% audience shares, you know, so everybody used to watch it. Mm-hmm. So HTV clung on much longer than anything else because so many people were watching it. Mm-hmm. And it's a shame that's gone now. Mm-hmm. But I'm really glad that there's this channel starting, Channel 8, mm-hmm. next year, I think. And I'm going to do all I can to support that. Because what was really interesting with HTV was, when you went there, you were told that the history of HTV was, it was Lord Harlech, that Richard Burton, Stanley Baker gave the money to start that. Mm-hmm. Hollywood superstars went, we're going to give them money to that start TV station in Wales. How fantastic is that? You know, imagine people like, you know, Michael Sheen or Reese going, there's some of my money, I'll start a channel again in Wales, which created this whole industry in Wales. And all those jobs, fantastic gift to give back to people in South Wales, you know. And I worked there and I started in drama because of regional television. Mm-hmm. You know, the biggest programme in the world, the biggest drama in the world, on this Coronation Street, started on Granada.
I was 2 years in Manchester just being shown before we ever went network. Mm-hmm. And that's all gone now, that is a shame. Mm-hmm. But you know, I think there's an opportunity for that to come back. Shane's a classic example, and Vicky, a powerhouse in Nottingham making This Is England, because it was shot there, used all workshop actors, and it's, you know, everybody would say it's probably the best piece of television in the last 5 years, you know, BAFTA winning, all shot in a regional area. So, you know, there's opportunities for you in South Wales to do stuff. I genuinely think that.
We can talk a little bit about how maybe with the decline in regional television there's some other opportunities which, because of technology, really have come up. But before, we've got a couple of clips, haven't we, Dave?
There's a couple of clips I thought John would like, because it shows his ability as a producer, as a presenter, as a diversification. And also one of Vicky, which shows an skills you probably never realised you have.
Something to the global reach of film.
Yeah,
it's great.
I can't
really
think
why we did it. No, I just like the idea. But it's interesting because coming from is that idea that you're in Nottingham, and I think it's important for these guys to, there's a wider world. It's not just about London. So that's my first of it. It's about this huge place out there. Yeah. You don't have to worry so much about London, because you can project yourself far beyond there if you've got the confidence with Shane McPherson. Shane and all you guys in Nottingham had, but you've got that courage, I suppose, to go up there.
I mean, it's interesting with things like This Is England and the TV series. America didn't really catch on to it, and you know, that's the obvious place after sort of here that you'd want everything to go sort of over there. And didn't really catch on to it, but then there's other jobs that I've done where they're like, yeah, America's picked it up straight away, or different countries have taken it. And you know, it's a very confusing business, really. You don't know where things are going to end up, and I think through the process of Jonny making this Bengali, I've sort of learned loads of stuff from the other end of it now, and the process of that is petrifying, because even with This Is England, I remember Mark Herbert, the producer of it, telling me just after I took my hair off, that one of the funding people had pulled out. So he didn't tell me, because I'd, you know, my hair was down to here, and all of a sudden it's been shaved off, and we're ready to go. And you know, a film like that, which obviously is great and it's done really well, but back then we didn't really know what he was going to do, and people weren't really buying into it as much as we'd hoped. And anyway, it was all fine.
I'm quite conscious that I want to like give people a chance to ask questions, but it's one thing I think we want to cover, talking about Svengali and how two of you work together, but also how Svengali came about, because I think that's quite an unusual, or would have been a very unusual story a few years ago when, I think 2008. So that's 5 years, and obviously the internet and TV and everything has changed a lot in the last 5 years. So do you want to just talk a little bit about how Svengali came about, because there's obviously music's a big influence again.
Yeah.
But in terms of the process of, I'm thinking in terms of like DIY, doing it for yourself and not waiting for someone to give you a check, like going into ITV Way or HD.
Yeah.
You know, it's not as simple as that.
No.
It certainly isn't anymore.
No.
So maybe a little bit about how the idea, maybe, but also how you thought, how am I going to get this idea made, really?
Yeah, it did kind of inadvertently pay for it, because I maybe redundant, and I need some money. But I had, I think I had also grand film or something, because I've been there for years. And I had an idea to shoot something. The internet then was very different than now, actually, because it was still full of kids falling off skateboards and loads of virals and all that. But YouTube didn't have the power to load more than about 4 or 5 minutes, I think it was. It was all different file sizes. It's amazing what's changed the file size. You can watch TV on, you can watch films. Then you can only watch clips. And computers couldn't cope with it, there was bandwidth and width and stuff. But I thought, if I put something on the internet which was, you know, story driven, a narrative, maybe people would like it. So I had an idea of somebody who was in a band, who was a manager of a band, who'd gone to London and was trying to get his band signed, and he was mod and he'd give everything up on tapes. Basically the idea really, and I just thought it'd be a funny story. And one of my best dealers friends is Dave's brother Roger Evans, who I've acted with for 100 years now, in everything. And we were chatting and I said, well, I got this idea, I'm just gonna shoot it and put it on the internet. And he went, let's just do it. And he always played the foil for me. You know, I was kind of like the early wise, really, the straight man always, and Roger was, you know, always the funny man. And he went, oh, do you know what? I'm just fed up being the funny man. Can I be the nasty ones? And I went, yeah, let's do a role swap, you know. So I wanted him to play somebody who was already in London, established themselves, who was Welsh. Because I wanted to create Welsh characters, lots of different Welsh characters, make them, you know, and also three-dimensional, so a bad Welsh guy, a good Welsh guy, you know, that kind of thing, so rather than just one Welsh bro. So we shot it in the street in London, ridiculous, man, no insurance, you can get arrested up there for doing it, literally, you know, CCTV, I didn't realise any of this, we shot it in the street, being Welsh, and we put it on the internet, and the Evening Standard said it was the best comedy they'd seen online. That's what happened. I got Mark Crick. And that gave attraction then. Because the Times then said it was really good. And through the broadsheets. And Time Out said it was the best thing I'd seen on the net. So I kind of realised I had something. And Vicky was talking about this. You know when something's good. It's really odd. You just have a feeling when something's good. You know, you just think this is all right. Because people, and I had loads of hits. So the next step to when I got Alan McGee involved, did another 5 minutes again. And then I had the most bizarre thing, like rock stars started getting in touch with me, like Carl Braff and Libertines and Oasis and Boy George were saying they wanted to be in it because I was getting people to play themselves. And then Martin Freeman, what happened was Martin Freeman got in touch with me from Food Mutual Friends. He really liked Spengali and he wanted to be in it. Martin Freeman, so I shot him Martin Freeman. And then YouTube got in touch with me, bizarrely. Because you think YouTube's run by like Pixies, and it was like, so somebody from YouTube said, can I meet me? And I was like, wow. So I met YouTube and they featured it. And I was like going, okay, so this is something new. But again, a great story for you all. Every broadcaster at the end, every broadcaster, BBC, Channel 4, Channel 5, so all said to me, yeah, I like this, we're not going to make it. And I was just going, oh, you know. So I got rejected by everybody. I got rejected by everybody.
But what was the reason behind that?
Just that they said, oh, it's funny, it's clever, we love it, we love the new character, it's really good, but we're not going to make it. Classic BBC, you know. Mm-hmm. So you just go, fucking hell.
So then commission another series of Vicar and Dibbler.
Absolutely. Yeah. So you just kind of go, oh God, this is never going to get made, you know. And I was a bit like, you know, like, I don't know why, I just kept going, but the character of BBC kept going. And I had this really weird phone, a guy phoned. No, I bumped into him at Premier for a film called Soul Boy with Martin Compton. Mm. And his name was Martin Root. And he went to me, I really like your thing, Sven Garland, oh, thanks very much. He went, can you come in for a chat? And I kind of went, yeah, I thought maybe he was a production company or something. And he went, I'm a creative design agency, which do designs and stuff. He did stuff like Pop Idol Design, Dave Beckham said, quite a big deal in London. And he said to me, I was skint, I was really on my arse at that point. I think I'd done an episode of My Family, I was laughing. And he says,
you should have got a clip of that.
He says to me, here's what we want to make. He says, look, I really like what you do. He says, I can make this into a film. I'll start a film company with you, half and half, and I can raise the funding for this. And I was a bit like, all right. And I said, all right. And he went, I'll pay you every month, X amount, so you can live, so you can develop it. All right, brilliant. Left the studio and fucking sat on the curb outside. What the fuck did that happen? So I was a bit like all over the shop, and he was as good as his word. He raised the money for the film, and the only stipulation from a private investor was, can we get Martin Freeman on board? And I went, yeah. And I emailed Martin, he'd just started on The Hobbit, and he said, we're back in January, if you film then, I can do it. Bless him, Martin sent this email. Bless him, saying, yeah, I do spend obviously. Funding dropped. And then I was driving back to Wales Christmas time, with a mutual friend from London called Cardiff Dave. He's from Cardiff, right? And we're on the motorway, right? And he's really funny. And what it is, he talks like that. He's drunk, Cardiff. I says, oh, I hear Stone Roses CD. And I went, stick that on. And he went, I don't play it until I get the sweet one. Because by the time he finishes, I'm in Cardiff. So I wasn't allowed to the CD on, right? It's Cardiff Dave's car. So I was playing about with the radio. And the weirdest thing, when Radio 1 was on, obviously, you know, nobody listens to Radio 1, unless you're 18. So I was on Radio 1, and he went, will you stop fucking about with the radio? Leave it on. So I was like, all right. So I left the radio, he's a radio on. And Vicky McClure comes on, talking to Edith Bowman. So obviously, I was a massive fan of Vicky, right up from Roman Brass days to this thing. But she was funny. Because obviously, Lon is very serious. She was really funny. She was like, and a laugh in the dorm and sort of chatting away. It was great. So I says, all right, guys. And, so I says, she sounds really fine, she sounds great. And he goes, yeah, she's great. You know, cut off listening. And I says, I think she's a great friend, I think she's a great Michelle. So I went back to London in a year, and I said to the casting people, I said, I really like Vicky McClure, I'd like her to play part in Spend Alley. And they went, you won't get it. You won't get it. It's impossible to get everyone. So I was like, oh, okay. So I said, well, let's send her the viral and a script, and let's at least see what she says. So her agent seen the viral and thought, and went, well, actually, I like this. She said, the problem is, she said, Vicky, we did eight scripts this weekend. And she's off to Russia to film Anna Karenina with Joe Wright. So I was like, okay. On the Monday then I get a call from the agent going, it's brilliant, like the Queen. Nicky's gonna call Jonny at 11 o'clock. So everybody in the office going,
I finished my 8 scripts.
Yeah. She must be interested to ring and all the rest of it. So then they started going, Jonny will get her. So I was like, oh, fucking pressure. Oh no, we'll just see. So the phone goes, I'm standing outside the office and I'm kind of going, hello, Vicky, and she goes, hi, Jonny. And before she starts the conversation, she goes, listen, before we start talking, I love the script, I love the film.
Yes.
So we were talking for half hour, didn't we, on the phone? And that was it, really. So I had Vicky McClure, whether he wanted, and Martin Freeman, obviously Raj, and a load of other people, and it got made into a film. From starting as a viral, it got made into a film. So it was like, I hate the word journey. I hate it when people go, it's an amazing journey.
He says he's going to use the word trip.
Trip. It's much more Welsh, isn't it? It's a great trip. Honest to God. Out in. It was like a shower bar out in. But you know what? The greatest artist probably the 20th century, historically are the Beatles, right? Let's just say the Beatles have more effect than anything else in the 20th century as artists. And there's a great thing with the Beatles, they got turned down by everybody. Every single person in the record should turn the Beatles down except for George Martin, who ran a comedy label on the record called Parlophone. And the reason why he liked them was because he'd seen something in them, not a song, Lovely Do So Rough. So if the Beatles were rejected by everybody, you should never be too hard on yourself if somebody goes, no. And that's what I kept thinking. You know, I went to see Channel 5 together. It was brilliant. We went to see Channel 5, right? It's a great story. Yeah. And one goes in and she goes, yeah, we like Sven Garden. I think Channel 5, the man has money, make a series. Brilliant. So we go, fantastic. She goes, listen, how many episodes do you want to do? And we're like, 10? She goes, yeah, fantastic. You know, how much do you want? And we're going, we can do them for 50 grand an episode. She goes, yeah, we can pledge that up. So we left building going, a series on Channel 5. The next week, Derek Redman, where he's called the porn baron,
Richard Desmond,
he took over and went, no more British dramas, we're going to buy in American stuff, CSI. So me and Roger, you can't compete against CSI, it's a £1 million budget, it's a £1 million London. Those are the kind of knockbacks we had all the time, and you just kind of go, you know what, somebody in the end will like it, hopefully, and that's the case. So, yeah.
What's the name of the British CSI style that is now on TV? There's a new program about play sheet production, but it's exactly CSI, but
you can... It's not like the deep. Is it?
Wicked the Dead. Wicked the Dead, is that it?
Wicked the Dead.
No, you have a CSI now, but you can invest in the CSI and do it.
You do a CSI?
No, I
do. CSI Golf Group? Yes, it's especially something like that. CSI Seven Wheels.
Yeah. No, was there any commissioning editors in there?
No, it was a big project.
To go back to the Sven Garley then, for you then, you read the script and you just thought, I want to do this. And have you read another script?
No, not Alec. I've got a really good agent who makes me sound like I'm hugely in demand. No, I didn't have 8 scripts, but I don't know why she said that. But I read it and I watched the Bibles and it's really nice because you read a lot of scripts and you do read sometimes a lot of the same thing, if you know what I mean. So this to me was a breath of fresh air, and also just, I can, it's like Jonny was saying, you just know You know, you just know when you're on something really, really good, really exciting. And for me, it was kind of like somebody's not gone, oh, well, let's get her in the dark role again, crying, and, you know, he kind of thought, maybe she can be funny.
What had you just done before you read Sven Gartner? You'd done something quite different.
Yeah, I've been filming Line of Duty and True Love and doing all these different dramas, and I'm just about to go out to Russia to shoot Anna Karenina, which I didn't feature in because I got caught. So that's just the reality again of the game, you know. Everyone's going, oh yeah, I've been to that Anna Karenina, I can't see you. But you know, it's funny with, just to go back to that, you know, Joe Wright, huge director, rings you up and says, I'm sorry. And I'm like, it's part and parcel of the game, that's what happened. So, you know, I got to go to Russia and get absolutely petrified. It's like, when I was petrified, the first time I met Jonny, I've got a scarf like over my face, it was freezing cold, wasn't it? And I was like, I've got to go to Russia and there's going to be wolves and I'm going to die. And he's like, oh God, all right. So, yeah, you can tell straight away that I was sort of petrified. But, yeah, I mean, Svengali, I'm kind of like, I'm bubbling inside with it because it's the first time that I've been able to do anything on screen that's light in that way. And I'm really proud of Jonny because of that journey, and I'm sort of really
like... It was a trip, I think it was a trip.
It was a trip, sorry.
It was a trip.
I'm all right with it. It was my turn. It is amazing what people do, and I love the fact that it's not just, you know, commissioned from somewhere. It's you know, it means a lot to him.
And next up, we've got Line of Duty Series 2.
Yeah, I start filming that in about 4 weeks in Belfast.
Okay, great. So we've got a couple of clips for me.
It's worthwhile saying the clip is up because we've got a bit of an embargo on the trailer for Sven Gartner, haven't we? Because it's all but
it's all
ready to go.
It's all in the middle of negotiations and stuff. Have you got the video, the first video?
The first video. Well, you've already talked about it, it's perfect. Yeah. It's like we've prepared.
Yeah. So watch these clips and then we'll open up to the book. For Vicky and Jonny, anything that you'd like answered for, just raise your hand, and then if you haven't got a microphone or anything like that, so just, anyone got anything you want to ask? Yeah,
hi. You've both got very strong regional identities. So if you could play any part that's around at the moment, film or television, what would you choose?
I want to be in Breaking Bad.
Do you, Alton?
I want to be in Mad Men. If you're going on that level.
Yeah.
That's my favourite thing, is being on television recently. Yeah, I think it's fantastic, so well done. And a period piece as well, really, for the 1960s in New York. So.
Starting
in the 70s, isn't it? But great choice of, you know, period.
Check out
New York,
amazing.
Yeah, no, there's a guy who's drawn that, who was famously drew stuff in the 60s itself. They found him, didn't they?
Brad Ainsley,
they found the guy. The new campaign, but originally did all the sort of drawings in the 60s. So the attention to detail is fantastic. Some of those big American series, amazing. You know, the HBO stuff, obviously. Big fan of Boardwalk Empire. Obviously Breaking Bad, but he's obsessed with Breaking Bad. You know, all those kind of series. I thought Deadwood was amazing. So it would be something like that, something quite historical.
If I could ask a quite controversial question, why do you think that we can't make those series, or why we are making them?
I have to tell you why, because we are in Britain obsessed with period piece dramas that tend to be sort of not about great. I mean, there's something being done in Birmingham called Peaky Blinders, which is apparently about the gardens of Birmingham in the 20th century. I do think we tend to do things in Britain which sell very well, so not an Ockham, but are kind of about kings and queens.
Are we talking Dublin?
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult to sort of, Benedict Cumberbatch tends to get those parts, you know, so when you're competing with somebody or Damien Lewis, who's, you know, who's been to, gone to pharma college and that way, and, you know, blessed them for it, you're not going to be seen from the relatively, unfortunately, but just fair enough.
You've got Kenny McDonald, though.
Say it again.
Kelly Donald,
yeah, she was great in Portal of Empire, yeah. She kind of she kind of became a movie star really early, didn't she, in Trainspotter, so that kind of depth of that.
She
was
quite a strong media identity, didn't she, sort of starting off. She
yeah, but she was brilliant in what's the film, the comic book is called, yeah, much more like so Ellen's in there.
Yeah, a lot of the characters got Welsh names.
Welsh names. Yeah, because the Southern States and the Welsh connection, so they say. But yeah, it would be Mad Men, I think it would be fine. Tell me a story about when the obsessed you got after that scene from the finish.
Oh, I got so obsessed with it. I was like, oh, it's on Netflix. Whatever, the episode. Yeah. And, you know, I'd done the right thing and watched them with Jonny. And then I was like, oh, let's watch another one. And anyway, before I knew it, I'd watched them all out and I'm saying, I'm so sorry, I've just gone back to back all day. So I was like that, a bit wired. And it's just, for me, Breaking Bad, it's all the acting in it is just flawless. And they're obviously given like free rein, do you know what I mean, to create these characters. And the guy who plays Jesse Pinkman was kind of not really known of. And he, I don't know, I can't remember the actual story about it, do you know? But I do know that he came from kind of nowhere, and he was only meant to be in it for a couple of episodes, and then before you know it, he's like, you know, one of the main guys. And
they kept writing him in, and
they just kept, yeah.
Basically, John Hamm was obviously Don Draper and Mad Men, completely unknown. You know, he was literally packed from waiting tables in Los Angeles, and you know, his performances are fantastic.
But you've got to have a budget, you know, the effects they use, the music they get hold of, you know, just everything about it. The writing's so clever. You know.
They obviously have a lot more money to spend.
Of
that's
course
it.
They do.
Yeah,
yeah.
Than we do. Really.
They have a lot more money, and
really?
You know, I'd love to see something that we may go on HBO and be as big as that. But you know, you've got to be brave, and I think Shane Meadows for me is obviously, you know, a big influence in my career. And for me, he's a brave director. Mm-hmm. You know, he goes, right, let's do a rape scene and do it really bad, to the point where people feel like they're in the room, do you know what I mean? And not a typical kind of down an alleyway where you'd expect it.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, it's about being brave and going, you know what, I will put it on TV. Because what people, I think one of the things we struggle with is that we need to spoon feed an audience, but we don't.
Mm-hmm.
People are really intelligent and, you know, they make their own decisions, and that's why people like to leave a bit of a cliffhanger on the end of things, because yeah, we've all got an imagination, and I think sometimes if you just put things out there that are too obvious, it just becomes, it's the same old shit.
Mm-hmm. Right. Dream scenario, right? HBO come in and say, we want to do something, £3 million the episode. Obviously, I'm going to go Mirth Arising, pick for there. I'm going to go Mamet's Woods, the story of the Welsh Division. You know, and Tom Pandy writes, I do all those things. The way that they have done stuff like Rome, Deadwood, was meticulously researched. I mean, they resurrected the Cornish language for that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, literally resurrected the language because they had the potential because of getting Cornish tin miners in.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, exploring the things. You know, you direct with me then.
Yeah, I'll be there. £3 million budget, I'll pick that.
Yeah,
I'll pick that tea.
I'll scratch my
Over the last sort of few years, it seems to be theatres what seems to get put up for predominantly all the time. And as you said, you know, the same old shit that you keep getting dealt with, and you look at it and you think, what is this? You know, every time I've got to go to London, I've got to pay £100. You don't get too cynical about it.
Yeah.
But, you know, where I'm at now, I really want to do TV and film. That's what I really, really want to do. And is it worth doing something just to say, oh, I'll you know, you're really looking hard for the positives in it, you know, and it'll pay the bills, it's a job, you know, and I'm not sure if it's worth doing that, or I'm just wondering what your
I'd say it's,
you know,
a bit of both really.
Yeah.
There was definitely times earlier on in my career where I had the day job and I was offered Crossroads. It was one of those jobs where I was like, I just can't do it. You know,
yeah.
I knew a lot of people that were in it. It was regional, it was being shot in Nottingham. And, you know, for me it was kind of like, well, it means I get to act every day and I get to get paid to act. But there was no way that my heart was in the job. And I just thought, I can't get up and go there every day with a heavy heart.
Yeah.
I'm better off going to my other job and keep grafting to get to
where I want to get. But and then there's the flip side of it, you know, with certain things where you'll do something that's a great script and there's absolutely no money in it. You know, you're not really going to get paid or, but it's an amazing film when you show reel. So you can go, it's all about
and
the
balance. And that's why I do that. You
yeah, exactly.
And you don't want to, you feel the pressure from your agent saying, you know, it'll be good for you, get through this, and you go, no, I know it isn't. Because like you said, it's the same shit. And I know you need to turn that and just felt like you're abused in the audition. You can send a
yeah.
away and you got to go, thanks very much. Yeah, it's a wonderful experience.
Yeah.
I'll get my four hours back home. And it's something you don't even care about.
It's, I mean, good stuff is like, you know, obviously short films, loads of studios do great short films and stuff.
Yeah.
Always keep, you know, your eye in for that. And your showreel, just build your showreel up then, like you said, stick really interesting stuff on that. And, you know, and people would take notice of it. And stuff like this, where you could just meet really good directors and things, you know, as director there, you know, Kerry does short films, because the film is fantastic. Always looking for actors, always looking for new people and stuff, you know, and so it's, I hate the word networking, but it is meeting people, and you know, look, you'll be amazed how many really interesting short films students made. I've done quite a few actually. I've done about four or five. I think you do stuff like this all the time, where people just say you do a short film, no money in it, but it's quite interesting. It's obviously it's a lot better than some of this TV stuff, which is, you know, run of the mill, and that's always a really good idea to keep an eye out for stuff like that. I mean, you know, it's just sort of
word of mouth,
yeah, get to know people.
Yeah.
Get to know sort of writers and directors and stuff like that. You know what I mean? You'd be fine.
Oh,
yeah. I don't mean to depress you about this mortal coil, but what would your legacy be after you passed away?
Legacy.
Yeah.
Do you know what's really funny? I was my father worked underground in literature, and then he went to steelworks and he had the more than three jobs really in his life, underground from when he was 15 to sort of like. Early 40s, I remember, it was about 12. He went to steelworks and he retired. And there was a big party for him the other day. It was quite packed, you know. And lads turned up and working on the grounds. And this fella said to me, "Your dad, come on, say your dad was the best troubleshooting electrician in South Wales. He was the best bog finder. There was nobody touching underground the steelworks." He said there was a problem. I remember we'd get out of bed and as a kid, he'd pull my brother out of bed because my mother was a K worker, so we were sleeping in his van and then with his coat. My mind was the water board, he was like up inside the mountain and the pumping station along then he'd fix it. And he loved that, you know, he loved fault finding. And this guy sort of said to me, he was the best. And I thought, what a brilliant legacy, to respect your peers. You know, and if somebody could say he was really good at what he did, I'd be happy with that.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know. I'm like Jonny, I'm really proud of not knowing where I come from.
I'm not from
Nottingham. But I'd like to think that I was remembered to be a really proud Notts girl because I've bloody talked about it.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I'll be gone, I won't care.
Yeah.
He came to the workshop. He did a film called 24/7 before he did Romeo Brass, and he cast a lot of the guys in that from the workshop. And then he came to do an audition for Romeo Brass, and the way the workshop works is it's under 11s, 11 to 16s, and then 16s and over. And obviously the dean was meant to be like 19 or something, I was 15 at the time. He came down, did some auditions, and then there was a recall, and I was the only one with a recall from the 11 to 16 group. So it was just like, I was so scared, because I was with all the older kids, and, you know, that just added more pressure. and Paddy Considine was down doing the auditions with him, so we was just doing some improvisation. And in the audition, we had to have like a bit of an argument. And all the other girls were like, really going at him. And I was like, oh my God, this is horrible. So I just went up and was like, yeah. And just played it really cool. Because I was really nervous. And got me the job. So, it was surreal, really. But I stayed in touch with Shane after that. And he is a really good friend. So there's always this talk, oh, we got cast for This Is England in a pub. It wasn't that. It was just we was in a pub and we talked about it, and then it just got so, yeah, I'm very lucky. Again, it's just, you know, look at the drama.
Anyone else? Yeah.
Thank you for continuing and thank you for doing for a moment. I wonder what the best director you ever worked with, who the best director you ever worked with was.
Kerry Collins.
I was just saying, it's really difficult.
Well, I mean, Shane Meadows for me is, he is the best director that I have ever worked with, in so much as I've worked with him that many times, and he's taught me an awful lot about what abilities I have, and just the way he runs his set, it is like no other. But Kerry Collins is also a fine director. as is John Hardwick, who directed Svengali. There's a lot of them out there, but when, you know, there's bad ones, they stick out like a sore thumb.
It would be John Hardwick, the guy that did Svengali, because he came on board kind of at sort of kind of late script stage, but was very just kind of agreed receptive to all ideas on set. So I mean, there was a script written, but I was kind of like wanted actors to move off script if they wanted. Some wanted to just say the lines, and others wanted to rip props, which is great. Vicky's a classic example of that. I've never known an actress to throw lines away so much. It's like most actors want to say more. Vicky, get going. I don't want to say that. I don't want to say that.
I don't want to say that.
Like,
all
right.
Yeah.
Can I just say nothing? Just. Yeah. So it was, you know, I liked the atmosphere that he created on set. He was very relaxed, and that was the way I worked. I mean, Vicky talks a lot about how Shane works, and he works in a very specific way where he kind of winds people up really to get the point of, you know, doing a certain thing, and that works for him. And I think that's the secret. Whatever works for the director is absolutely a relationship player. It worked for me when I was on Svengali, and I was obviously writing. I was a producer, and I was working with John. I just wanted to just get everybody as absolutely relaxed as possible. So I let the band in it have some cans. They wanted to have some cans. Like, you know, I let people kind of, you know, within reason, say and do an act that they want. And I think the atmosphere was quite good on set.
Yeah, it was great.
So, you know, that was the way that I liked to work, you know, as much as I could. You know, I wasn't precious with, as long as it kind of kept the narrative of the story, it sounds fine. And then we stuck to it, you know, and I think most actors will do that, but sometimes they'll surprise you and do something brilliant, you know, with a certain scene or something, and we'll be accepted for that as well. I've just been shot by a lady.
Another question there?
Hi, I'm Dave. Hey. Is there any characters you played that you thought, oh, bugger, I wish you didn't play them?
Yeah, I'm sure there are. I don't know if I want to look at it. You know, sometimes you make a choice and it isn't like, it's not that you don't expect it, it's you can't do what you want to do with it when you get there. But I mean, majority of the time, like I was saying to you, you pick what you want to do. If you don't like the job, then don't do it, because you forget that after the job you've got to sell it, you've got to go and do press and go, it's amazing and blah, 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 and you know, you can't do that and lie, because, well, morally for me, I can't do it, so I've just sort of stepped away from it. But yeah, sometimes I have this.
I did a thing very early on, just after Nuts and Bolts, big BBC network drama with Neil Pearson and like David Welsh took in that, and they wanted it done, really, compared to the audition. I don't know why, I fought against it, but it was, in the end they kind of went, look, you know, we needed to walk with a limp, and be a bit slow, and I was a bit like, all right. Obviously I was just going, well, he's just, you know, he's just a bloke in the valleys, you know, he's just, it's not, doesn't mean slow, whatever. And I talked too quickly, that's my problem. But yeah, so but I had to sort of do that. I could fought against it. That was something that I probably wouldn't have done now, but I did at the time. But you learn really, just, you know, like he said, sometimes you take parts and just go, you know, I took it and try to make the best of it. But that's probably what I would have done everywhere. Thank you.
Question here?
Yeah.
How are we doing for time, Dave? We,
yeah, I think we've already given this another couple of questions here to read. To read this one there.
Yeah.
Oh, hi. It's really nice to meet you all, by the way. It's fantastic. Doing publishing, I don't find out about it recently, and I found out from the website I'm very, very interested in starting something like this in Brighton, where I live at the moment, originally from Wales, but I live in Brighton now. Although it's only 50 miles from London, the kids there do seem to be marginalised slightly because they've got a big music scene there.
Mm.
There's a lot of successes that have come out of Brighton. When it comes to things like film, they don't seem to have a chance. And there's a lot of poor kids there as well. There's a lot of kids who don't have a chance to go up to London, even though it's not that far away. So my thing is to find out more about Zoom Comedy and try and replicate something down there. And I've been talking to some of the younger kids, and they say one of their biggest barriers is, yeah, it's money, expectation, and also this self-awareness thing that you talked about really well earlier. And I've gone too long, sorry. I saw an interview the other day with Daniel Craig, and he said that self-awareness is really crippling in art. And it leads then to insecurity, and you can't do what you want to do. Now, whether it's me setting up something in Brighton, or the kids being able to say, yeah, I can do this, what do you think is the biggest battle that they face to overcome these insecurities?
London is just quite intimidating, really.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
it's, and it takes getting used to. I know it sounds really weird, but like the tubes and the busyness of it, and just the sheer size of it, you know, and it could be overwhelming. You know, if you're
Welsh,
that's
to me,
it's expensive.
Yeah, I mean, as much as it being expensive in London is just overwhelming. I spent a year there last year, and whilst I learned to love it, it, you know, also did my head in a bit. But nobody in this business would, you know, we all admit there is a lot of bullshit. And it's because part of us as actors, we have these insecurities where it's like, if you watched, I don't know, whatever's on at the minute and you go, oh yeah, you're great in that, you kind of go, oh, brilliant. If you go, oh, you're not good in it, then it doesn't set you up very well to go off and do your next job. And it's like, you know, your agent's there to make sure that you're told that you're great, and that these people, you know, if the feedback, they come back and go, oh, you didn't get the job, but they thought you was amazing. You know, it's all that, and it's part and parcel of what goes off there. But then you're set up for, you're amazing.
Yeah. That first time you ever did something, though, in front of somebody, that first barrier to say, oh, people watching me.
Yeah.
And all these other people here are going to have that, whether it's in acting or something. What made you tick you over? Was it because you had that ambition? Because you wanted something bigger? What was that thing?
I'm just always, I mean, from the age of three, I've been dancing. So I've just always been prancing around doing something or other, you know.
Yeah.
I just urged to perform.
Could I pick up on something as well? Because I think there's a big difference for me, and one of the reasons I invited John and Vicky here tonight was because they come from kind of a little bit outside the traditional system, and I'd like to pinpoint the fact that Vicky's been through the workshop system, and I think there's a huge difference between the type of work that goes on in workshops and what goes on in some. I saw criticisms to places like Stagecoach, which is about, you know, it's jazz hands and putting on a song and a dance, and I think the workshop system is really good for those kids that don't have that urge to show off and dress, do the tap dance, you know, whatever it is, that kind of...
It's okay to make it easy.
Yeah, it was, and I'll tell you, the funny thing is when I started there, I was 11 years old, and it just goes to show that Ian Smith, who runs a workshop, is a legend within his own right, and I sat there at 11 in a circle full of kids who have been going for years, and I didn't get the big celebratory welcome because I didn't get in first time, and then I was a reserve, and they were like, come down Tuesday night and start. And I sort of just checked my watch very briefly, and Ian went, if you don't like it, you know where the door is. I was like, oh my God, I don't mean, and absolutely petrified me. But it was basically, this is how it is here. You know, it's messy, the place is an absolute shithole. But it's great because you can go out and pick anything up, I can do what I want with anything. You know, you're not scared to touch anything, you're not scared to go and grab props and mess about, and you're a free spirit when you're down there. And there was rich, there was poor, there was, you know, everybody in there was a complete individual, and you could tell that person doesn't want to act. They're not here to be, they don't want to be famous. You know, that's another big thing about nowadays is, you know, people just want to be in the magazines or want to be on telly. They think that you're going to be sickly rich, which, you know, I'm sorry to tell everybody, but, you know, the business just doesn't run in that kind of money anymore. Soap actors don't get the same that soap actors used to get. So there's this real, the media have made it out like it's the most glamorous job in the world. And, you know, there are days when it is, but then there's days when it's just, you know, it's about sort of those, your, you know, kids that you're going to be dealing with, having the reality of it, but also, you know, if they've got it in them,
yeah,
they'll go for it.
Trying to get it out.
Yeah.
And the kind of thing, and that's the thing about the workshop, for me with being a band, is like, you're us against the world, that really helps. It just gives a gang of kids.
Yeah.
It's not so intimidating to go to London together. And I think for some like workshop, if one breaks out, like Samantha Morton, everybody else goes, well, you know, we can follow her. Mm-hmm. When I was in a band, it was like, sort of like, Manic's got signed, sort of.
Yeah,
and then we can, oh, we can do that as well. So that really helps, I think, is a gang of kids together, it's brilliant, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
Just got time for one last question. Rhonda, you had your hand up.
It does follow on a little bit from what you were saying here. I was just really occurred to me when you were talking about your, I won't call it a journey. I came down on the way here. I worked for Banks Kids, which is one of the sort of funding people that we've been working in partnership with a young boy, you know, probably fits all the titles of, he's immensely talented. Very, very able and doesn't like school. And we were having a conversation about where his next step is. He's on a kind of placement with us. And I'm fascinated by this idea that on one level, you know, our thing has been to really, really want to push young people on to say, you know, you can get back into education and you can make something of yourself. And we've been in an experience where we've had a young person who, you know, he went on his own path. He managed to get into, he was in a BAFTA award winning film, Anna Asante's film, as a young guy who hadn't been from a performance. Those are the sorts of young people who would come to our workshops, as you describe them. But there's a point at which for the young people, that, you know, they're all young people from the Valleys, that's where I work in the South Wales Valleys. That resilience that you talk about is quite a precious thing, and it needs to be, I think people do need to be supported. Sometimes you talk about having a great family,
but
if you don't necessarily have that around you, that you're really talented, then you do need something that's going to kind of catch you a little bit to take all the knocks and the setbacks. So my fear was, he described it as after that the train track stopped. He didn't have the resilience to be able to carry on taking the sort of rejection path that you talked about. You know, he got into casualty, he did a few more things. So we'd be more persuasive to say to young people, go and get that training, so you've got a little bit more back.
Yeah, I mean,
but I'm hearing from you guys, so I'm just interested in that dilemma, in a way. How much do you, because through training you all get, also get support, you also get backup from lecturers, from people who take an interest in you. If you go it alone, you know, it's an interesting
thing. The thing is, it's the difficult business, because there's no obvious path, and you're going to do where you gravitate to. And, you know, I've been seen to say things in the press before about, you know, God is overrated. It can be overrated, because not everybody can take that kind of road. Not everybody's going to get in. There's only so many places. And, you know, I think drama school is great for people that can go in there and learn skills. Like, I wish I could reel off accents like that, because I've been trained to, I can't. So it's slightly harder for me when somebody says, oh, you know, you're going to go for an audition, but you need to do an Irish accent tomorrow. I'd be like, don't bother, because you know, I'd need training, and I'm behind on stuff like that. Whereas, so it's difficult because for him, you know, I remember doing Romeo Brass at 15, leaving school thinking I was Julia Roberts because I'm in the cinema, and absolutely nothing happened. And I went to college for 4 months, and I came out of that because it didn't stimulate me. You know, I didn't really get much of an education because I was too busy just acting and dancing, and that is what my thing was. And then I spent 2 years working in H. Samuels. I spent a year working in Dorothy Perkins. You know, I just carried on doing jobs because you've got to earn money, and that that's just the way it is. So, as much as I still knew I wanted to do it, it wasn't like I was up for an audition every week or, you know, I was constantly involved in stuff. I just had to crack on with life. So it's hard because you want to go to people, go out there and follow your dream, and, you know, you're obviously talented, go and show it off and, you know, grab all the opportunities you can. But I also try and make people as aware as possible just to go, there's going to be the real shitty times where you just got to be normal and you've got to just carry on with reality and kind of that's all part and parcel of your journey. But it is. But no, it's really hard because
I get kids emailing me quite a lot, you know, from the valleys going, what do I do? You know, 86, 60, Jonny, go in touch with him, what are you doing? And I say to every single one the same thing. I go, get your A-levels, try and get the English if you can. I go to drama school if you want to be an actor. That's why I said them every single one without exception. That's the best way to do it. The way I did it was arse backwards and all wrong. But the way I would say to any kid, you know, get your qualifications, go to your course, if you can, go to drama school, and see what you get from there. It's the best way of getting on. That was that question. You'd agree with that, wouldn't
you? Oh, you know, you're guaranteed an audience full of agents when you graduate. Yeah. They're going to come in and say, can I have a look and see what you've got? You know, we didn't get that. But there are other things, you know, it's like, this is so important, you know, what we're doing today and what you're all involved in. This is all part and parcel of it because you don't know who's going to meet. You know, we keep saying Kerry, but me and Jonny work with Kerry, and, you know, he's a bloody good director who's up and coming, and soon people will be banging the door down to work with him, speak to him, because you don't know what he might, it's silly things like that, and he'll remember, and then all of a sudden you don't know what you're going to be attached to. So yeah, go to drama school, yes, get your A-levels. I mean, I haven't got an A-level to I got a BAFTA, so I've done it. But you know, that was pure luck. You know, I didn't know Shane was going to make 86. I didn't know anything was going to come after This Is England. Who knows? What's with the laser?
I would say, I would say to a kid like that, if you can get strong,
that's
how
it happened to you, because we've heard so much of the other side. Yeah, and that was... completely understand and
people
do extraordinary things, but it's just the balance as well.
Yeah.
You know, also,
we'll
all just go out there and...
No, you can't. No,
education.
Get your exams,
all
right?
Email, we've got it all wrong.
No. It's not true, it is about getting the qualification, and it is definitely the route to, you know, I would say.
But I would add to that as well, it's also about those kids for whom, you know, that they're not, you know, they're not going to get a degree. There are a lot of kids out there that we, you know, that we work with, that they shouldn't be written off either.
No.
And I think that's the important message, because you've both got very... But maybe that's not clear, the very different routes, because you've got a degree in
history.
In history, you've come through the work that you and you are. but it is, because I think we write people off, you know, and we shouldn't write them off.
I just
called Taylor in that generation where it was not okay to be brainy, but it was good to be brainy. So kids who were like seen as brainy kids, well, it was cool. Like,
remember? Right,
it was kids who went on to degrees. It was thing. So all of you were in college. It's a really good thing. You know, it's great. You know, I'm a great believer that, you know, education, reading, studying, you know, watch films, do as much as you can. You know, that is the secret.
I actually went to college for 4 months to study drama, But it was crap. I'm not going to lie, it was just a really bad course. And I said to them, I've been in a feature film, my grades were terrible. So they were like, you're going in the lowest course. So I'm going, I've done a feature film. You know, I've been to the workshop since I was 11. And I'm saying this to these people, and they go, no, you haven't got the grades. So I'm stood there pretending to be a tree. And I'm like, well, that's a it just goes to show that I did try and educate myself and think the best thing to do would be to go to college and study drama, which I did, and it was terrible. So, you know, it was a backlash for me because I thought I was disappointed at this. You know, that was wrong with the college, really. If they'd have put me in a better course, then maybe I'd have carried it through.
I make films, seriously, it's got cameras, go off, yeah, iPhone,
your phone.
Just shoot stuff.
What's the secret?
Right. So, Aspen, do you think the Atrium is the answer for the Welsh?
I knew you'd ask it.
No, it's interesting because I'm from Lisbon and I'm used to people like you back to our reality. Some of my best mates, they are also on the TV and they're acting. I've done several workshops too with the top names. I'm just studying music now, just promote Wales in a way.
Yeah.
And because you are a Welsh citizen, you think the Atrium is an answer for the people that want to be actors like you in the music, in the acting industry, or else only the Welsh College of Music and Drama?
I think they both are it. I think
it's a mix up, isn't it? Like,
no, well, I mean, I think Atrium, from what I understand, is much more about the technical side of things as well. So sort of, you know, about sort of, you know, working in creative into that, aren't they? Atrium is about all aspects, I think, as well. Do you know what I mean? It's sort of the technical side of things. They learn about shooting and editing and that. Whereas the Welsh College is, I think, much more about performance, acting, music.
Mm-hmm.
Got a fantastic history and reputation. You know, it's got some amazing people that come from there. And something like Atrium is only going to produce, you know, it's only going to give people the opportunity to have a chance to, you know, to learn and to do things. And I just think that's a good thing. You know, I think any kind of it's a tough times, you know, in Portugal and Britain, there's no money going into anything, it's such a shame. And I think that's really important because if you invest in people and you invest in, you know, kids and equipment and give them the chance to learn, that's the most important thing of all, because otherwise, what chance have they got to learn anything, really? So I think it's a really important thing.
Yeah, brilliant.
It's a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And you're very welcome in Wales as well.
You're very welcome.
Very welcome.
I'm working with lots of people in Wales and organisations.
Brilliant.
I'm going to have to wrap it up a bit, but I'm sure that we'll all be going over for a pint across the road, I think, in Porters later. So we can carry on the conversation.
I just want to say, Gemma's just reminded me that if you're on Twitter, the hashtag Zoom2013, if you want to start meeting other people and talking about what you've seen today and what's going on.
Just at Zoom Cymru.
At Zoom Cymru on Twitter.
Hashtag Zoom2013 for any comments and feedback about today.
Yeah.
And the rest of the week.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.